Hello everyone, welcome to this video V6NA program for the subject on climatology for architecture students with subject code 18 years. We are in module 2, last lecture on the topic thermal performance of building elements. In last lecture of this module 2, in last two lectures in fact, we have discussed about thermophysical properties of different building elements, and in this lecture we are going to talk about the thermal performance of these building elements. We discussed about material properties of building materials. Let's say we discussed about brick, and we know different thermal properties like conductivity, resistivity, resistance, conductance and other properties. And there are other heat flow properties that we have discussed, how it behaves with respect to building materials and in building spaces. Now we are going to see how these thermophysical properties can be seen with respect to building elements like wall, roof, window and glass. And let us understand more about certain calculations, how to calculate how much heat is flowing through the wall, how much heat is entering the glass. Right? So in this thermal performance of building elements lecture, we are going to discuss about heat flow through building elements. So basically we will talk about the heat gain that is happening or heat loss that is happening through buildings, how that is being seen in buildings, that can be understood. Then we discuss about conduction, convection, radiation, which we have almost covered in last two lectures also, but we will try to revise with certain calculations here. Then we have something called internal heat gains. So this is something which we haven't discussed in last lecture, which is very important in understanding the total building's thermal performance in any given case. Then there is evaporation and condensation that we also discuss, and we do minor calculations on topics. So basically, if you remember in our earlier lectures and in module 1 from our other professor, you would have discussed about this, you know, the thermal balance of human body, the total heat gain and the total heat loss, should be balanced out. So similarly, the way it happens with human body, the heat exchange process with the environment has to be analyzed for buildings also. In this lecture, the building shall be considered as a defined unit, and the heat exchange process with the outdoor environment be examined. So ultimately, why we are constructing our buildings? We want to stay in that house and be comfortable. It is not just the safety and protection, the main criteria to construct a house, right? It is not just safety from animals, safety from your burglars, who might come and take your assets. So that's not the only concern while making a building. The major concern, the major purpose of making a house or making any building is to keep the user comfortable irrespective of the harsh weather conditions that are happening outside, which is changing from time to time very dynamically. So now, what happens to the temperature, what happens to the the condition, the weather condition inside the building, the indoor, the thermal conditions of the indoor spaces is completely dependent on the changing outdoor conditions. So with respect to outdoor conditions, how indoor conditions are being impacted and how it is being changed is something that we have to understand the heat flow through buildings and the thermal balance of a building. So here there are different ways the heat comes in or heat goes out. We know that the radiation that comes from the sun that hits the roof, hits the wall, and if there is glass, it enters the building. Then through these walls or the roof, the heat keeps coming inside, or in cold climates, the heat might go outside through conduction. So this is through conduction from the walls, from the roof, and from the floor that happens with the conduction. And then we have convection. If the window is open, the airflow that happens from inside to outside gives us the way the heat is moving in and out through convection. Then we have mechanical systems. So we have, let's say we have a fan, we have a heater, we have a air conditioning system. So there are different mechanical systems which also add heat to the room or take out heat to the room. So that is what is mechanical controls, which is heat through mechanical controls, which is QM here. Then we have evaporation. So evaporation, not just from the building, it is within the building also. The evaporation, if there are 15 people who are sitting and doing some activity in the house, the evaporation that happens in those human bodies is also emitting heat in the form of evaporation, which is added to the ambient air inside the room. So this is also a heat gain that happens within the indoors. Then we have different indoor appliances like lights, you have computers, you have printers, or you have different other electronic or appliances that emit some heat. Let us say we take a projector. The projector, while it is projecting the light to give you the scene what you want to see, it keeps emitting certain heat there. You take any tungsten bulb also. The bulb, apart from what the light that it gives, it also emits some heat, and that's why it is very very hot if you go and touch that tungsten bulb. So might not be that much of heat that is being emitted from LED lights today, but any light has certain amount of the energy, the power that it takes, will be emitted as heat. Not 100% of the energy that is given as input is converted as heat, as light. So certain amount will be emitted as heat. So all this heat is also as an adds to the internal spaces. So we have conduction. We have conduction where the heat gain and heat loss are happening. So we have solar heat gain, which is from solar radiation that falls on the building and enters through conduction or through radiation. Then ventilation, which is openable windows. Then we have internal heat gains, QI. Then we have seen mechanical controls and evaporation heat. So all these are different aspects that we need to understand in two different major segregation as internal heat gain and external heat gain. So any heat that comes from the sun or outdoor temperatures through conduction or convection or ventilation or radiation is all considered as external heat gain. And any heat that is generated from the indoors is what is called as internal heat gain. So here we are talking about external heat gain, internal heat gain. It can be heat loss and internal external heat loss also. It depends on the conditions or the temperatures indoors and outdoors that are being maintained. So we know that internal heat gain, the solar heat gain plus internal heat gains plus conduction heat gain. You see there is plus or minus here, because from conduction heat can go out or heat can come inside. Same thing with ventilation heat less heat gain or heat loss. So that's why it's again plus or minus. Then mechanical systems also. Let us say you open a refrigerator. You have a refrigerator in one room. You just open the refrigerator. What the purpose of the refrigerator is to take the heat and throw it out. And if the heat is being thrown out or if the heat is being taken out, the chillness that it is being kept there in will be spread out to the room, which means the room temperature is being reduced, which means the sum of the heat is being taken by the refrigerator or air conditioning system. So that is mechanical systems. If you have an air conditioning system which is maintaining the room at certain temperature, it is taking the heat from the room and throwing it out. So that's the purpose of air conditioning system. So this is a kind of heat taken out, which is heat loss. Let us say we have a heater in the room, room heaters, which is generally used in cold places. So if you go to any cold places, you might find a fireplace near their living room or seating area. So the fireplace place is being lit with the wood, firewood, and the heat is being generated into the room, which is again a heat gain into the room through that particular fire system or a room heater. So in the last one, we have evaporative heat loss, because heat is being lost from the building. That is why it is minus here. Though it is evaporative heat loss from the building systems that is being taken out. So all this heat gain or heat loss from the building. So we are talking about the building here. So for the space or the particular room with the envelope system as a one entity, the total heat gain and the total heat loss should be balanced out to zero. So this is what would happen eventually. The total heat that is coming, the total heat that is being delivered from that building as a whole, should be equal to zero, and that's how we meet the thermal balance of a building. So like the way we have seen our human body and understood the thermal balance, the similar way here also for the building that it should be zero. And if it is more than zero, the temperature in the building will increase. If it is more than zero, which means there is certain heat gain. If it is more like in general, in a house, if you in your own house, if you are staying in your house in summers, where in summers you feel that the temperatures indoors are much growing much higher beyond your comfort zone. So let us say 24, 26 degrees is our comfort zone, and the temperatures are going beyond 30, 30, 31, 32. Where is this increasing temperature coming into the building? There is certain heat added, and that's why the temperature is being increased in the indoor temperature. So the heat that is coming inside can be in any one of these forms, and eventually it is not being lost. It is not being given out to the environment. Let us say it is very hot outside, by opening windows, maybe through ventilation, heat cannot go out. Maybe the extra heat might come inside. So how much heat is coming inside and how much heat is not able to go outside is what that the heat that is being trapped inside your house, and that is what is increasing your temperatures and making you uncomfortable beyond your comfortable limit. And this is something that we need to understand where which heat that is unwanted heat that is coming inside the building should be cut down. Similarly, for cold climates, it should be more heat gain. So your internal heat gain should be more compared to the heat loss that is happening into the building for you to feel comfortable. Otherwise, it is very chilled environment, 0 degrees or 5 degrees outside. Your whole heat, even if you are staying at 20 degrees centigrade, the heat is still trying to go outside through your walls, through your windows, through your other systems. So ultimately, what we need to say, do is to stop this heat loss happening so that you can feel comfortable at your room temperature when the heat is being retained, when the heat is being added more for you to feel comfortable compared to the very cold outdoor conditions. So this is a major difference for hot places and cold places. Eventually, we need to maintain the internal heat that is being there in the room not to go out or not to bring in more and more heat. Maintain it our required thermal conditions to make us feel comfortable at comfort levels. So let us see through each and every aspect of this heat gain, heat loss happening through different aspects like conduction, convection, and other mediums, other methods of modes of heat transfer. Let us get into this conduction mode here. So in conduction, the heat is occurred through the walls, either inwards or outside. It can be either wall or roof or whichever the envelope component you take. It can be glass, it can be wall, it can be roof. It can go out, the heat can go out through conduction, heat can come inside through conduction. So the convective and radiant components of the transfer of the same heat. So there is certain convective and radiant components of the same heat at the surfaces is being factored in transmittance. We have discussed this in our last lecture in detail. We have also discussed that this is what is we read it as U values very well. So this is the transmittance is what is no, denoted as U value. So we know U value one, and we know the area of the surface, how much area of the surface that is being seen, and we know the temperature difference. So we also have discussed that the U value is nothing but the amount of heat that is flowing, the amount of heat that goes from one side to other side of the building. Per unit area that we have discussed, that per unit area and per 1 degree change in temperature. So if I take it in the if I do this calculation with to calculate the overall heat gain, so U value multiplied by area multiplied by temperature gives us the total heat gain that is happening through that wall. Here the conduction is in watts. We have area in surface square meters and U value the degrees watts per meter square per degree centigrade we have discussed. And the temperature difference in degrees centigrade. So once we know these four values, we can calculate the exact heat gain happening from that wall. Let us see a quick calculation with one of the building examples that we have with us. So this is a room which has full glass here. So you can see that there is glass in whole this portion. So this whole portion has glass. Now let us just try and see how much heat that heat is coming from this whole glass here. Let us say the area is 10 square meters, maybe about 2.5 meters height by 4 meters wide maybe. So I'm just taking it for calculation purpose. Let us say this is 10 square meters and the temperature outside is maintained at is for that particular time, so it keeps changing. We know that it keeps changing from time to time. So at that particular time when we are calculating, maybe we are calculating it for 1 hour, and that 1 hour the temperature outside, let us say it is 30 degrees centigrade. I'm taking it little hotter compared to indoors when indoor temperatures are kept at 24 degrees centigrade. Let us just assume that it is 6 degrees difference from outdoor to indoor. But if you can see that there is this fireplace happening here, which means that I'm assuming that the place is very cold place where the temperatures are much lesser than the comfort temperatures. But for calculation, let us say outside is hotter and indoors are cooler, so that heat is coming outside to inside, just for calculation purpose in this particular example. So let us say this glass, particular glass which is being used here, has a U value of 5 watts per square degree centigrade. So U value is 5, and we have 10 square meters of area and 6 degrees centigrade temperature difference from outdoor to indoor. So now total heat that is coming from that particular sorry for so total heat that comes from outside to inside here is will be area, which is 10 into U value, which is 5, into temperature difference, which is 6. That is 300 watts of heat that comes. 300 watts of heat is coming if the temperature difference is maintained at 6 degrees centigrade. 300 watts of heat is coming from that particular window area of 10 square meters we have taken. So this means that 300 joules per second. So each and every second, this window is allowing 300 joules for the whole window, not for 1 square meter. So 1 square meter is what is U value. So we are multiplying that U value with the whole window area, which means for 1 degree change in temperature for 1 square meter, there is 5 watts of heat that is coming, and that's what this U value mean with us, right? So when we know that 5 watts of heat is coming for 1 square meter for 1 degree change in temperature, for 10 square meters it is 50 watts that is coming for 1 degree change in temperature, and the temperature difference is 6 degrees as we know, which means 50 watts into 6 will become 300 watts of heat coming in. Now if this 300 watts of heat, and like let us say 300 watts of heat coming in, which means this is equivalent to say you have a good refrigerator, a very very energy efficient refrigerator, which would be roughly rated at 300 watts to 500 watts. So the amount of energy that we consume for a refrigerator, or maybe a fan is of 60 watts generally, maybe amount of energy that you consume for 5 fans is the amount of heat that is actually coming from this particular glass at this given conditions. So let us say if the temperature difference is 6 degrees centigrade, but on the other side is lower and the indoors are higher. Let us say indoors are 24 degrees and the outside temperature is 18 degrees centigrade. The calculation remains same, but this 300 watts would be going out from the room. So if you are using a heater of 300 watts, the amount of heat that is generated by this heater, the whole heat will be going out only from this one window. And there are other windows and other sides of the envelope. The roof is also there. From the roof, conduction is also happening. Now, if you really clearly understand, we are talking about clearly only the heat gain through conduction. So we are clear about conduction with this calculation. If you see this picture, there is sun set happening, and maybe the sun rays are coming inside. You can see the shadow patterns that are falling up here, right? So we have the shadows falling here and the shadows falling here, which means that some amount of solar radiation is coming inside. Now this is what is heat transfer that is happening through radiation. So now this heat transfer through radiation is not being factored when we are calculating this heat gain through conduction. So the glass, in the last lecture we have discussed, the glass has a property of U value which talks about conduction, which can reduce the outdoor temperature indoor temperature impact for heat gain. So that when there is difference in outdoor indoor temperatures, the heat flow that is happening is being affected by the thickness of the glass or the layers, double layered, triple layered glass, which will have better U value, which means lower U value. If the U value is lower, the heat flow coming through the glass will be much lower. So we are talking only about the heat flow coming through conduction, not the heat that is coming through radiation. To cut down the radiation, if you really want to cut down the radiation, we need to have shading, we need to have colored glass or tinted glass, so that your SHGC, in the last lecture again we have discussed, solar heat gain coefficient has to be minimized. The overall solar heat gain factor has to be minimized so that the direct radiation is being cut down. But in the let us say this place is in a cold climatic condition, where your outdoor temperatures are very, very low, and you need to add more heat in the room to feel yourself comfortable, right? So for you to feel yourself comfortable, you need more heat. And when the sun is giving heat, you have to allow heat to add more heat into the room through radiation also. At the same time, you should not lose your heat through conduction, because outdoor temperatures are lower and indoor temperatures are higher. Your heat should not go out. So your glass should have better U value, which is not allowing heat to go outside through conduction, but we are trying to add heat through radiation. So the glass should be clear to allow radiation. The glass should be layered to cut down the conduction, which is where your internal heat is going out of your room. So this is for cold climatic condition. When we talk about hot places, you have to cut down the heat gain, because outdoors are very hot, indoors are maintained lower. You have to cut down the heat coming from outside, so your U value should be lower again. At the same time, your solar heat gain coefficient also should be lower, so that heat from radiation is also being cut down and making your room being at comfortable zone without adding more and more heat, either through conduction or through radiation. So this is what we have a clear difference about conduction and radiation heat gain. So in this room, we are seeing a different room here, where this is the outer wall, let us say, and this outer wall has this much of window. So this window has glass, which is allowing direct radiation maybe, but the U value of this wall is, let us say, 9-inch brick wall, which has U value of 2.5 watt per meter square degree Kelvin, and glass has 5 units of conduction U value. Similar case in the last case we have discussed. So let us say glass area is about 6 square meters, and wall area is about 30 square meters, just for calculation purpose. So we calculate the heat gain through the wall separately. We have calculate heat gain through the glass separately. Again, only for conduction. We are not talking about radiation. For radiation, the wall is already factoring in the solar air radiation, the outer layer of the solar temperature, which we have discussed yesterday. The surface conductance is also being factored in U value. So the radiation on the wall is also already factored in the U value calculations. When it comes to glass, we are talking now only about the glass U value with the surface conductance, of course, but the radiative heat gain, the radiation that comes directly, is not factored in this. So we calculate the U value, the thermal conductance only through the heat transfer only through thermal conductance through these calculations using the formula which we have discussed here, and add them up to get the actual result. So the temperature difference, as we have discussed for cold climates, the temperature difference will be indoor minus outdoor, because the outdoors are very, very, very cold. So it is in this case we are talking about heat loss calculations. So you can see the ice being formed on the surface of this building. The outdoors are 0 or minus degree centigrade, when indoors are maintained at thermal comfort conditions, maybe at 18 degrees, 20 degrees. Because when it is very cold outside, you can feel comfortable even at 18, 20 degrees centigrade. When it is very hot outside, you need higher temperatures to make yourself feel comfortable. Otherwise, you'll feel very, very cold. So your comfort condition, we can't say that we are always comfortable at 24 degrees centigrade. Your comfort condition is dependent upon your ambient external temperatures. If it is very hot place, like 40 degree, 45 degrees outdoors in summers, in such places, maybe 18 degrees might make you feel very, very, very cold. But if the outdoors are minus degree centigrade in such kind of scenarios where outdoors are being frozen, even 18 degrees is very comfortable condition, because you are getting warmth compared to your outdoor condition. In any case, in cold places, we are looking at heat loss, and that's why the indoor to outdoor is much more apt calculation for the temperature difference. So transmittance for composite walls. Let us say, in this case, we are talking about one brick wall which has 2.5 watt per meter square Kelvin. But what if there are two, three different layers of wall? I'm constructing with two, three different layers. So how do we calculate? In the last lecture, we have quickly calculated one with one example. Now we see a bit more detailed calculation in this. So this is the scenario. You can just pause the video and just go through them very clearly and understand what are the different layers that we have in this composite wall. So there is a wall which has this 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 layers, and once these 6 layers are constructed with a given thickness, We are going to calculate the overall thermal transmittance of this particular composite wall. In this one, if you see, we have 114 mm brickwork, which is around one brick wall, 114 mm brickwork. Then 50 mm cavity, which is nearly 2 inches cavity. So there is nothing here, which is just left open here. Then we have 100 mm concrete blocks. So we have 4 inches concrete blocks here. Then we have 25 mm wood wool slab. So we have a wood wool, which is insulation material, which is being added into this particular wall assembly. So don't worry about the thickness here. I'm just randomly drawing here. Then we do plastering of 12 mm outside. Then we have surface resistance, of course, which is the outside air surface film that adds up to this surface resistance of this particular wall assembly. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 different layers, and we know that to calculate the overall U value, either we should be having U value or so U value, which is also calculated as 1 by R. Or U value is also proportionate to A, but inversely proportionate to thickness. So to calculate U value, we should have K and thickness, or this R value. So here surface resistance, here if you see 1 by F naught, which is outside FO, and 1 by FI. So this is conductance, surface conductance outdoor, surface conductance indoor. 1 by surface conductance will give resistance here. So this is resistance of outdoor film, outdoor surface, and resistance of indoor surface. So here 50 mm cavity, the resistance of the cavity is being given directly. You can see the units here, meter square, degree Kelvin per watt. But for all other materials, we have K value and thickness. So once we know K value and thickness, we divide K value by thickness to get the U value of that particular wall section, or you can calculate resistance of that particular wall section by calculating T by K. So once we do T by K, we get resistance for all the different elements. Now we know that U value is not additive directly, so we first calculate the resistance of the overall wall assembly, which will be R1 plus R2 plus R3 and so on, R6. So we get R, and then the overall U value of the wall assembly would be 1 by total R resistance assembly. So this is the way we do calculate the total thermal transmittance for a composite wall. So you can see here the resistance of this surface, indoor surface, outdoor surface. We are coming from outdoor to indoor here maybe. So yeah, so this is R naught, which is outdoor surface resistance. And then we have, this is 1 by F indoor, which is indoor surface resistance. This is for indoor. Then we have four different, so the cavity is already given. So remaining areas we are calculating by thickness by conductivity. So thickness by conductivity will give us resistance values. By adding all these resistance values, we get the summation of the resistance as 0.837. 1 by 0.837 will give us the total U value, which is 1.19 watts per meter square degree centigrade. So if we have discussed roughly about for 9-inch brick wall, the U value would be nearly about 2.5 watt per meter square degree centigrade. By adding different layers, your overall resistance of the wall increases, which means your U value is reduced further. The overall heat gain is reduced further. So that's why this 1.19 watt per meter square degree centigrade is much better U value compared to a normal 9-inch brick wall. So by adding insulation, by adding more layers, you are trying to add more resistance. More the resistance, lesser the U value. Lesser the U value, lesser the heat flow that is happening through your wall or any other wall assembly or roof assembly. So we have discussed about the glass and for wall, how the overall heat transfer that happens for that particular surface area of a given room. Similarly, after calculating this overall U value of a wall assembly, we use this U value to calculate the overall heat flow happening through that particular wall or roof or any other material. So I hope you are clear with this U value, conduction and the heat flow that happens through conduction with this example. You can take out certain values from your Koenigsberger book, or the in the last lecture I had given a clue for a link for Econiverse Samhita. You can download any of these reports and or check the book and find out the U values or thermal resistance or the conductivity values, the K values, and you decide your own thicknesses. So you have your K value, you have decided your thickness. Once you know K and thickness, you know the resistance of that particular wall as wall material. And then by adding 2-3 layers of this, what is the overall U value of that that you can achieve is something that you can do it as an exercise for yourself. So keep exploring with these exercises and try and see what are the different options that you can explore with different materials for wall and roof with respect to reducing the U value, which means increasing the insulation capacity or the heat restriction capacity for your wall, so that your heat gain or heat loss is reduced to a required extent. Next comes this convection heat gain or heat loss, the convection heat flow, which is something where your air movement from indoors to the outdoors is happening and the heat flow from outdoor to indoor is happening. So this is generally done in two different ways. One is forced ventilation or free ventilation. Free ventilation is your natural ventilation where you just open your windows. Because of the thermal difference from outdoor to indoor, the air exchange keeps happening. But we know that in very hot places, if you keep windows open, your indoors also get too hot because your hot air and is being replacing the your cold air inside, and the heat exchange happening through air movement from indoors to outdoors will make your room too hot. So so there may be unintentional air infiltration or maybe deliberate ventilation. So here forced ventilation is nothing but your fans or air conditioning system where we know that you know, you are adding air or throwing out air. By increasing the speed of the fan, you are making the air to increase the pressure in the room, and the pressure will make the air to exchange with the outdoor conditions. So there are different ways. If your window areas are more, your air exchange happening from indoor to outdoor is more. If your window areas are window area in the given room with respect to floor area is lesser, your ventilation is also being changed or affected accordingly. So the rate of ventilation can be generally given in meter cube per second. Amount of volume of air that is being changed per second. So that is rate of ventilation. We are not talking about heat gain here. So when we talk about heat gain, the heat through ventilation, we generally take it as rate of ventilation and temperature difference. So if the temperature difference is more, the rate of ventilation for one unit temperature difference, the delta T, is multiplied with this rate. And 1300 is being used as a multiplying factor here, which is volumetric specific heat of air. You need that much of heat in for the air for 1 degree change in temperature. So in your room, if the temperature is at 24 degrees centigrade and outdoor temperature is 30 degrees centigrade, because of the 6 degrees centigrade, the outdoor temperatures are 30. So until the air movement is happening, until your indoor is becoming 30 degrees centigrade. So in that case, the temperature difference is 6 degrees centigrade, and the ventilation rate, and if you are adding or removing heat through your air movement through your fan or something, is being used. So you multiply the ventilation rate and thermal temperature difference with 1300, which is your volumetric specific heat. We get the total heat that is gained or lost through ventilation. So if you know the number of changes per hour, this N is called number of changes per hour. So this is being calculated generally if you have an exhaust fan, let us say. Exhaust fan can take out certain amount of air in the cross section area. So it's called air velocity again, cross sectional area velocity. You multiply it with the amount of time that it takes, you get the volume of air that is taken out by your exhaust fan. So if your room volume is x cubic meters, if the fan can take out 10 times the room volume in a given time, let us say, so that becomes your number of air changes. If your room of the volume is 10 cubic meter, in the given in 1 hour span, if for 10 cubic meters of the room volume is being exchanged 10 times, which is 100 cubic meter of air exchange is happening, then the number of air changes per hour is 10 here. So you multiply the 10 with the number of air changes with the volume of the room and divided by 3600, which is nothing but your number of seconds in given 1 hour. So that gives your ventilation rate. If you don't know the ventilation rate calculation, so this is how we can calculate the ventilation rate if we know the number of air changes per hour. So a number of air changes per hour, sometimes it can be a thumb rule based calculations for your natural ventilation also, which might not be precise. But if it is a mechanical ventilation where you're calculating amount of heat that is being taken out or brought in through different mechanical means, you can calculate exact values and get to this number. Then comes radiation. So here we know that the amount of radiation that is coming inside the building or through the glass or windows, or the radiation that is falling on the outer surfaces of the your opaque walls and roofs. So here it is the density of air flow rate will have to be multiplied by area of aperture. So this heat flow rate is again in watts here. So the heat flow through the unglazed aperture, this is the heat flow rate through unglazed aperture. So when we talk about aperture, it is nothing but your windows. If the intensity of solar radiation incident on a plane of window is known, this itself is the value denoting the density of heat flow, which means the amount of radiation which is falling on the glass is the amount of radiation that is going to come inside if the window is clear. So that is the radiation that is coming inside your window. If your glass has different properties, then again this will be changed accordingly. So here the solar heat flow equation is calculated as the area of the window. We know that incident radiation, how much is the incident radiation? So radiation heat flow density is the incident radiation heat flow multiplied by area. So for 1 square meter, how much is the radiation falling on that particular glass? Then area, you know, then you know this solar gain factor, which is your factor amount of heat that is being allowed through that window. So intensity into area into solar heat gain factors gives us the total heat that is gained through radiation. So for glazed window, your radiation that is being coming inside is calculated through the radiant incident radiation multiplied by area and amount of heat that is being absorbed through your glass, which is your solar heat gain factor, which can be SHGC or shading coefficient, will give us the amount of heat that is finally entering your building. So in the previous slide, this unglazed aperture is nothing but your walls or any other surface material, where your total energy that is falling on that particular surface is what the radiation heat gain that is happening, which is being factored in the surface temperatures calculations of solar temperature, which we have discussed earlier. Then we are going to see this concept called greenhouse effect. You would have seen the nursery plantations. They grow small plants in very cold places by covering up with thin transparent sheets. So by the reason for covering those plants with these thin transparent sheets is to trap the solar heat, and keep these plants warmer. So these kind of nurseries, you would generally find these covered nurseries only in the cold weather conditions where the temperatures are very low, and even the dew or the mist that falls due to the lower temperatures on these plants also might affect the plant's growth, and the temperature itself might affect the plant's growth. So you need a warmer conditions, and to keep the warmer rooms, so this greenhouse effect is being used. So what we do generally in greenhouse is to cover up this whole this thing with a transparent system, the transparent envelope system. Instead of having opaque systems, we keep this transparent, where the solar radiation is being allowed to come inside and adds heat into this space. So now when the solar radiation is coming, we have short wave radiation and long wave radiation. So here short wave radiation incident on the glass is partly reflected, partly absorbed, but mainly transmitted. So your short wave radiation is very little reflected, very little absorbed, but mostly the short wave radiation is allowed inside. And the long wave radiation will be the absorbed energy causes rise in temperature and its energy is this absorbed short wave radiation is falling on this object, and this will become the long wave radiation that is being emitted back from this object which is getting heated up. So you are taking a glass box, you are keeping an object, your short wave radiation enters into the room and heatens up this object, and the object will get heated up and then emits that heat back in the form of long wave radiation. If you are getting confused with this short wave and long wave radiation, let us say radio waves, you can talk about the infrared rays. The radio waves and infrared rays, these are all long wave radiations, which are on the higher side of the wavelength of your solar spectrum. So this higher radiation waves generally doesn't carry too much of heat, too much of energy. So more energy is there in the lower short wave radiations. For example, X-rays, gamma rays. So gamma rays is the most powerful one, X-rays. That's why we should not get exposed to X-rays for longer periods, because it has too much of energy, it might affect our human body. Especially ultraviolet rays, this is not as severe as X-rays and gamma rays, but ultraviolet rays, you know that violet is the lowest in the Wibgeor spectrum. Violet is the lowest wavelength, and before that the much lower one is what is seen as ultraviolet rays. And we all know that ultraviolet rays has severe impacts on the human skin. So that is, you can understand that shortwave radiation is something that is having more energy, and the long wave radiation is having lesser, is carrying lesser energy. So in greenhouse effect, the long wave radiation is being cut off. Long wave radiation cannot enter glass so quickly, so easily, but short wave radiation can be absorbed and emitted inside, or the directly transmission is also happening to a greater extent. Generally, this glass acts as a opaque object, opaque substance for long wave radiation, for any radio waves or any infrared rays. So infrared rays are being cut from this glass. So what happens here is glass is opaque to long wave radiation, and it encloses the emitter. The heat is trapped within the enclosure. So what we are trying to do here, by covering up with glass or any transparent sheet or transparent material, you are allowing the shortwave radiation, adding up more heat to the objects inside the space, and those objects are allowing it back as long wave radiation, which is not being allowed to cross this glass envelope, and thus the heat is being trapped inside. So if you understand, a lot of times we keep discussing that we are copying from the West, and Western buildings are all glass buildings, we should not make glass buildings. The reason why Western countries, especially the far northern hemisphere and the far southern hemisphere countries, are making the glass buildings is to keep themselves warmer during the daytimes. When there is sun, when the sun is coming and hitting the building, you allow as much as sun to come and trap the heat, and thus you can improve your indoor temperatures to comfort levels compared to very chill and cold outdoor temperatures. So the similar case is being used by this greenhouse effect is being used for our nursery plantations, where you have to grow very small sprouts and plants within a controlled environment where it is warmer than the surrounding spaces. So that's how greenhouse effect is being used. And you would have studied this particular greenhouse effect in your school, in your high school, with respect to Earth and Earth's atmosphere and the layers that creates this greenhouse effect, and the emissions that we are giving, the carbon dioxide and other dust particles, whatever emissions that we are giving, is forming a layer or disturbing this greenhouse effect that is happening, or increasing this greenhouse effect. And because of the greenhouse effect being formed in the atmospheric layers, our Earth's temperature is being increased. So this concept, this idea of trapping heat of solar radiation through solar radiation, is something that we are applying for buildings to make the user comfortable in some places. And in some places, we have to be careful so that this heat is not being allowed, especially in the hot places where if the temperatures are already higher, you don't want any other heat to come inside your building. So here, we understood different radiation, heat gain, convection, conduction here till now. So now there is something called internal heat gains. Internal heat gain is majorly the heat gain that happens in the indoors, especially through human bodies or any other activities that we keep doing, or any non-mechanical activity. Even your pet animals also emit certain heat. Or any other activity that we add up heat in the internal spaces is what we call as internal heat gain. Typically, we use human body emissions. This also, again, you would have discussed in your first lecture in one of the videos, where we know that how we emit certain amount of heat, each one of us, by doing different activities. If you're dancing or doing some exercise in the house, you're emitting too much of heat. So when you add up more and more heat in the room, if 10 people are dancing, 10 people are doing exercise, you add up too much of heat into the room, and the room temperature also gets higher, and that's why you might need more conditioned systems to throw out this heat again back into the outdoor environment. So this is internal heat gain. The heat output rate appropriate to the activity has to be understood and thus can be multiplied by number of occupants. So what is the activity that we do, how much heat that we emit multiplied by number of people who are doing that much activity will give us the exact value of this internal heat gain to calculate. So this again is calculated in watts. The result is calculated in watts, the significant component of internal heat gain. The larger part of this energy is emitted as heat. 95% is emitted as heat for incandescent lamps. 95, 97. So here, the total rate of energy emission of electrical lamps. So we are talking about lights and lighting systems here. The electric, as we have discussed in the initial slides, that the electrical lamps take some energies, take the power, and the whole energy that is being given as input is not coming as light in the form of light. It is coming certain portion in the form of heat. So for different types of lights, for incandescent lamp, it is 95% of the energy given is coming out as heat. And for fluorescent lamps, it is 79%. For LEDs, it might be very less, maybe 20-30% of the energy given is coming out as heat. But generally, lights emit heat along with the lighting. So this heat that is coming from the lights and the lighting systems or any other equipment or appliances in the internal spaces is also the heat that is being added into the room apart from the heat that comes from human beings. So internal heat gain can be from the lights, from your, you know, kitchen activities. So you have a room heaters or something that adds up heat, and you have your room radiators or certain electrical equipments that also adds up heat. So these are all internal heat gains that keeps happening inside a building. So if there is any mechanical system, if there is an electric motor and a machine driven by it are both located and operating in the same place, the total wattage of the motor. So we know a motor which uses some power. So we know the wattage of the motor, or if the HP of the horsepower of the motor is known, we convert it into wattage, and that wattage is what being used for calculating the amount of heat that is generated. Now here, not every energy that is given in terms of watts or horsepower through that motor is being used for the work to be done. The motor will use certain work to be done, certain energy to for doing the work task to be done, and the remaining power, the remaining energy that we keep giving is emitted in the form of heat. Best example is your ceiling fans. You after running the ceiling fan for half an hour, you just go and touch the ceiling fan. It is super hot and it is emitting heat even after switching off the fan. So the energy given to the fan is used in rotating the fan and give you the air, and a part of it is being given is being used or is being emitted in the form of heat, is being lost in the form of heat. So that comes with this efficiency, which is efficiency of that power. So W into efficiency gives us the overall energy that is being actually used. So 1 minus efficiency into W will give us the heat flow that is actually adding heat into the room. So for any mechanical equipment, if W is the wattage, the total heat that is given, and if certain amount of heat that is being coming out as heat from that equipment, from that appliance, from that motor, that heat is being added as internal heat gain in our calculations. So we have seen lights, we have seen human beings, and we have seen any appliances and motors. All these three can add up to the internal heat gain. Then comes this evaporative heat gain. In fact, we should say here heat loss. So the evaporation rate is expressed in terms of kilogram per hour. So the corresponding heat loss rate can be found. So here the 666 is nothing but the latent heat of evaporation of water around 20 degrees centigrade. So this latent heat is 2400 joules. 2400 joules divided by 3600 seconds gives us 666 watts. So 666 watts into the amount of evaporation rate that we know. Once we multiply them, we get the amount of heat, total heat that is being added into the space or the lost from the space in terms of evaporation that can be calculated. Generally, it is not easy to calculate exactly what is the evaporation rate of heat, the heat rate, because we keep getting very variable aspects such as moisture, humidity, temperature, and velocity of air movement. Because these four are being changed from every time to time, are very dynamic, and it is not easy for us to exactly evaluate the evaporation to any precision. But it can be measured indirectly by measuring the reduction of quantity of water in an open vessel. So you keep an open vessel, amount of water that is being evaporated is something that can be used to as an evaluating tool to calculate the evaporation heat that is being generated or lost from given space. So generally, this is being used to reduce the air temperature. So in a hot place where it is dry place, in fact, especially when there is humidity is lesser, the evaporative cooling is being used as a tool to take the air for evaporation to happen. So what happens in evaporative cooling, as we discussed in very long back in our first lectures of module 2, that water to evaporate needs certain heat to be absorbed. So when water is getting evaporated, any evaporation process that is happening is absorbing certain heat from the surrounding environment. And that is why we always keep a negative sign for evaporative cooling. If you check your thermal balance for the equation which we have discussed earlier, the evaporation is always taking heat from the surrounding air. That is why the space is losing heat for this particular process to happen. So higher the evaporation, more the heat loss from the room space that is happening. So in hot places where it is dry and hot place, in your room, if you just place a water body inside the room, maybe that water body, you know, because of the dryness or because of the heat that is there in the room, because the room is very at very high temperatures, the evaporative cooling process might happen. And because the evaporation is happening, it adds humidity to the room. The humidity might increase in the absolute humidity might increase in the room, but the heat in the room is being taken for this process of evaporation, and thus the room has lost some heat for this evaporation process. So that is why evaporation is always in negative sign. So then there is something called thermal gradients. I think in the last lecture we have drawn a quick drawing regarding this. So the variance in temperature through cross section of a construction assembly. So we have four different layers of a wall, let's say, and the variation in the temperature from outdoor to indoor is something that we can draw, and that slope of this you know, temperature levels from section to section is something that we term it as thermal gradient. So assume a case where internal temperature is 20 degrees, outdoors is 0 degrees. You understand that this is for very cold place, where outdoors are very cold and it might be snowing there, and the temperatures are very zero outside, and the indoors are maintained at 20 degrees centigrade. This can be anything around. We can even consider the outdoor temperatures are 45 degrees and the indoor temperatures are 25 degrees, with a 20 degree change in temperature difference for outside to inside. So let us see how to draw this temperature gradient for a given wall. So here we have the example that we have just discussed some time back. We have a brick wall. We have a brick wall. The same example which we used for thermal transmittance calculation in the same lecture. So then we have cavity which is of 50 mm. Then we have concrete. We have wood wool which is insulator. We have plaster, and there is internal layer of internal surface conductance and outdoor surface conductance. So now we need to understand what is the thermal gradient here. To understand this, we are going to place this thickness, place this whole thickness of the wall into a different scale here, which is what is reading in terms of its resistance. So this is resistance. Each 1 mm is defining 0.01 meter square per degree centigrade, 0.01 meter square degree centigrade per watt. So this is the resistance value. So more the resistance, the x-axis distance that it takes will be higher. So in this whole assembly, we know that in even brick wall is of 115 mm thickness. This wood wool, which is very high insulating material, even though it is of only very thin thickness, the resistance offered by this wood wool will be very high. You can see here the highest resistance offered in this whole assembly is wood wool. Then we have cavity, which is again much better resistance offering layer in the whole assembly. Compared to brick and concrete, the cavity is adding more resistance. So higher the R value for this, higher this length of it. So let us go through that calculation very quickly and see what is the resistance values here. You can see wood wool is 0.269, but for brickwork is only 0.099, which is almost 20 times, or I would say 0.09. This is 0.1, this is almost half of it. brickwork is almost half of the wood wool with respect to R value. So this R values are being plotted in this particular drawing, where x-axis is being defined with this R value. Then we have this 20 degree centigrade here and 0 degree centigrade here, which is marked in this particular axis, y-axis. So once we know this gradient here, so this gradient with respect to the R value is being spread out evenly. And now you take this particular height, this particular gap that is being formed here, and make sure that they are being plotted here so that we get the thermal gradient for this wall section. So this is the wall section that we are trying to address with respect to thermal gradients for the given conditions of outdoor 0 and indoor 20 degrees centigrade. If I really want to check this for outdoor temperature as say 20 35 degrees centigrade, and indoor as 25 degrees centigrade, let us say. So indoor, let us say this is 25 degrees centigrade here, this is outdoor 35 degrees centigrade. I will draw this one here, so, and then I will project it here so that I'll get a gradient curve, maybe something like this, where outdoor is higher and indoor is lower, and I get the gradient curves accordingly for each and every part of this. This is how we draw thermal gradients for different wall sections. So you can take one or two layers of your wall section and try to create a situation where your outdoor temperature is hotter and indoor temperature is lower, and then try to calculate or draw the thermal gradient curves for your own wall and check it up. So this can be a good exercise that you can work out and calculate and see how the wall section actually performs with respect to its resistance values and thermal trend. So these are the steps that you can check up in your notes to see how to read it and how to create this thermal trends. Then there is something called condensation. So we all know that the air has certain holding capacity of the air, holding capacity of the moisture. So when the temperature reaches the dew point temperature, the air cannot hold that much of more, any more water, any more moisture, and the moisture will be falling as dew onto your surfaces. So generally in winter seasons, if the temperatures are going way below 15-20 degrees or 15 degrees or 11 degrees, based on the moisture levels, especially if it is very cold but very high humid place, the more colder the place would become, the humidity, though the absolute humidity is lower, you feel it has super saturated humidity because the air holding capacity itself is reduced. Simply, higher the temperatures, air can hold more moisture. Lower the temperatures, air cannot hold that much moisture. The extra moisture that air cannot hold will be seen as dew drops onto your ground or any other surfaces that the dew forms. So here, this happens when relative humidity is at 100%. We know that is called saturation humidity. That's where the dew or condensation will appear. So what happens here is, in psychrometric chart, we all have studied earlier in our initial lectures of module 2 that this is WBT, these lines are WBT, and these lines are these vertical lines are dry bulb temperature, and we know that this line is 100% RH line. So this is 100% RH line. These are all RH lines which are going in the curvilinear fashion. But if you see this one here, this grams of water per gram, this is nothing but your absolute humidity. So let us say this point, for this point especially, we are talking about this point here. So at 20 degrees centigrade, at 60% relative humidity, this is the point. Now we have the relative humidity as 60%, which means you have certain absolute humidity with you, right? Let us say this is equal to absolute humidity of about 7 grams of water per 7 per gram of air. So this is gram of dry air. So when we consider the dry air volume with respect to the moisture content. So don't worry about the number there, just try to understand that this line is your absolute humidity line. So let us say we are not changing the moisture in the air, we are keeping the same moisture, but we are changing the temperature. what happens in the night times when we go to bed at 10 p.m. the temperatures might be normal, but at 4 a.m., 5 a.m. the moisture content is same in the air, but the temperatures are falling down. So when the temperature falls down to certain extent, where this line meets this 100% saturation, if the temperature is somewhere around 13 degrees centigrade here, so at 13 degrees centigrade with the same moisture, it reaches its saturation temperature. And any temperature below that, which means if I say 10 degrees centigrade, at 10 degrees centigrade, its holding capacity of absolute humidity is comparably lesser. This extra moisture that we have will be seen as dew drops that would be falling from the air, because air couldn't hold that extra moisture. So once it reaches that dew temperature, which is your saturated humidity temperature, the temperature at which the saturation humidity happens for that humidity levels, that is where the dew starts forming up. So this is something that we can understand. And surface condensation is something that all of you would have observed, this kind of the water droplets that forms on your glass layers. This especially happens when the temperatures on the other side of the layer is drastically different at below the condensation levels. So if you observe this, if you want to check this very on a day-to-day basis, whenever you buy Coca-Cola, Pepsi bottles from a store which is very chilled, which is below the condensation temperature for that humidity levels. I'm not talking about the bottle humidity levels, I'm talking about the air humidity levels. You take out the very chilled bottle, you just keep it outside for a certain time. Because the internal temperatures is very, very, very low, the humidity on the surrounding air, when it touches this surface, which is at condensation, the dew point temperature, the moisture here will get condensed and forms as a layer of droplets that forms over there. So the surrounding air, the moisture in the surrounding air becomes condensed due to the low temperatures offered by this bottle with the liquid inside, and the surface is very, very, very at low temperatures, which is making this surrounding moisture in the adjacent air to get condensed on that bottle. This is how the condensation happens for on a surface when there is very large difference between the temperatures, especially it is crossing its dew point temperature for the given humidity levels. So here if this air comes in contact with the surface having temperature less than 12 degrees centigrade, surface condensation will appear. So this is familiar occurrence on a bathroom mirror or inside a cold window pane. So whenever you see this water droplets falling down, this means there is certain moisture which is beyond the holding capacity of that particular temperature. That moisture is being formed as a condensed water that is coming down here. Now let us say this is a very cold place. We know in winter seasons the outside temperatures in cold places goes near to 0 to 5 degrees centigrade. So when the indoor spaces also has certain moisture, right? So this moisture, when the air touches this glass, which is at very low temperatures, obviously this condensation happens. But imagine the glass is not a single layered glass, it is double layered glass with highly insulation, that argon gas or whatever we have discussed, where the heat movement is very well restricted. The U value of this particular glass is very, very, very low compared to a single glazing. So when there are two, three layers of glass and there is air gap, which is inert gas, the heat is not being transferred. The inert surface is not as cold as the outer surface, and that's why in this particular case, there is no condensation happening, but here it is happening. In the same room with the same humidity levels, because the surface temperatures are not reaching the condensation or dew point temperatures as it is happening in this case because of the single glazing. So this is how condensation happens. And condensation need not happen only on the glass on the surfaces. There is something called interstitial condensation, where you have your wall assembly, or you have a single wall, a brick wall, let us say. We know the thermal gradient that is happening inside this wall. So let us say this is the thermal gradient that is happening inside this wall. Sorry, here it's given as 21 and 0 here. So the thermal gradient will be this way. Maybe for the humidity, the water vapor which is being absorbed by this material, maybe this is the temperature. At certain temperature, your dew point temperature might happen. So this is 0 degrees, this is 21 degrees. So let us say this is this is 7 degrees centigrade, which is the dew point temperature for that given humidity. So this water vapor will get condensed at this point of the wall section. So water getting absorbed by the wall, within the wall, the condensation that happens at certain point where it meets the dew point temperature is something that we call as interstitial condensation. So this is not very, very, very much applicable to Indian conditions, because we don't reach this dew point temperature so easily in most of the places, except it is except if the place is in a very cold place or very hilly region place or in the Himalayan belt. So this is called interstitial condensation. So we draw the temperature gradient and then we try to understand where it happens and try to provide certain measures where this particular issue is not going to dampen the whole wall or create further issues to the wall. So this is how this will help in cold places to make your buildings not getting affected by these temperatures and water humidity levels. So once we know this, all the heat gains that are happening or heat losses that are happening, by understanding this, if we understand that if something is getting much higher, maybe for example the conduction heat gain is very high compared to all other losses, and if this value becomes zero, greater than zero, mainly because of conduction, let us say, then you have to address your conduction in your glass walls and roof, so that your building can be kept at very good thermal conditions, thermally comfortable conditions. So this is something that we can calculate. This is something that we can understand. Before we start the designs, we can even think about how different spaces, how different designs, how different materials can react, how behave with respect to thermal changes from outdoors to indoors. So we have climatic data, we have weather data where each and every hour we know what is the weather outside and how it is changing, what is the maximum, what is minimum, and once we know that, we know the sun path diagram, we know when the sun is adding radiation, how much radiation is being fallen on the roof, on different walls, on the glass, and what angle the sun is giving the radiation at a given time and how it is changing from time to time. So we have all the information related to the temperatures, the radiation. And these are the two major aspects, the outdoor temperatures and the radiation heat gain, which are very well important to understand a place with respect to its climatic conditions, and which helps us in deciding or defining our design conditions, how we have to make our building design to be done. So architects have a big role in making the building energy efficient or building climatic responsive by addressing these heat gain, heat loss factors to making a good building form, building shape of the building, the orientation of the building, the amount of the surface area of the building that is exposed to the outdoor sun or sun radiation. All these factors can be discussed, can be thought of in the initial stages of the design to make the building very much climatic responsive. Then comes the building materials and the amount of openings that we give, what type of material, what type of wall assembly that we are using, what type of roof, how we are insulating or shading the roof, how we are providing the glass, what type of glass we are using, whether we are shading it or not. All these elements and materials can be chosen and designed so that your heat gain, heat loss is well thought of and kept to its minimum affected levels. And then if you still don't get the comfort levels inside, then we can look for any mechanical systems like fans and air conditioning systems. And that should be our last resort after attempting all our passive cooling strategies with respect to those points which I have just mentioned earlier. So this is where we are going to stop this lecture, and that ends this module 3, so module 2 of this climatology course of in ARC 33 under VTU Belgaum. So in the next module, maybe in 4 lectures of the module 3, we are going to discuss more in detail about this thermal performance of buildings. And we do some more calculations and get into further details of how a building can be much more climatic responsive with respect to its design techniques, which design techniques can be employed in terms of making the building more climatic. So in this module 2, we have discussed about what is thermal comfort and what is seen as thermal comfort and how a person can feel thermally comfortable. And then we have seen different thermal properties of the space and the materials. And then we have also discussed about sun path diagram, and we have seen how sun movement and solar radiation affects the building systems and the thermal conditions of a building. And here we have discussed about different thermal properties and thermal behavior of the building envelope and building elements and building materials. So I hope you have got a clear picture about all these points which we have discussed in this module 2. And in module 3, we will further discuss in detail on how to make the buildings much more climatic responsive with all the information that we have in. So thank you very much for staying with me. We'll see you in the next module again. With many more details regarding climate responsive design. Thank you so much. See you again.